a song of rapture and shall never roam
up yonder.
Hallelujah. When we get home in the morning, we will walk the golden streets and never go astray
or wander.
So happy and so proud,
hallelujah.
I am riding on that glory cloud. We will sing a song of rapture and shall never roam
up yonder.
Hallelujah. When we get home in the morning, we will walk the golden streets and never go astray
or wander.
Are hard and the battle is hot, and the race that you run takes more strength than you've got. When it seems your endurance is put to the test, and many around you have decided to rest,
take one more step and stay in the race, and the Spirit of God will give you the grace. Even though you may stumble, don't fall down and die. Just around the bend, the finish line is in sight.
Just a few more steps and lift up your head. Always take heed to the things God has said. You'll be tempted to stop if you look side to side. When your body gets weary, keep your eyes on the prize.
Take one more step and stay in the race, and the Spirit of God will give you the grace. Even though you may stumble, don't fall down and die. Just around the bend, the finish line is in sight.
Always remember, through the centuries gone, many have run the race and gone home. Can you see them standing there cheering us on? The great cloud of witnesses saying,
run on! Take one more step and stay in the race, and the Spirit of God will give you the grace. Even though you may stumble, don't fall down and die. Just around the bend, the finish line is in sight. Take one more step and stay in the race, and the Spirit of God will give you the grace. Even though you may stumble, don't fall down and die. Just around the bend, the finish line is in sight. Even though you may stumble, don't fall down and die. Just around the bend, the finish line is in sight.
Love will never give, never give up. Even when the going gets tough, there's no valley that he won't walk through. 'Cause love will never give up on you, love will never give up on you. Love took the mountain, love took your cross. He went down for the count when he counted the cost. Love made the grave an empty tomb. Love will never give up on you. Love will never give up on you. Love will never give, never give up. Even when the going gets tough, there's no valley that he won't walk through. 'Cause love will never give up on you. Love will never give up on you.
Love is a lion.
Love is a lamb. 'Cause he was and he is and forever I am.
He hears your cry and he will prove that love will never give up on you.
Love will never give up on you. Love will never give, never give up. Even when the going gets tough, there's no valley that he won't walk through. 'Cause love will never give up on you. Love will never give up on you. Love will never, he'll never give up.
Even when the
going gets tough, there's no valley that he won't walk through. 'Cause love will never give up on you. Love will never give up on you. Love will never give, never give up. Even when the going gets tough, there's no valley that he won't walk through. 'Cause love will never give up on you. He will never give up on you. God will never give up on you.
One fish could they show, but with a word from the Lord they let down their net on the other side of the boat. On the other side of the boat, just a few feet away, the Lord filled their net and gave them stop praying for something that you've asked the Lord to do. Salvation for a loved one or just a special need for you. Keep on praying, remember the story, for your answer could be so close. For the Lord may be going to fill your net on the other side of the boat. On the other side of the boat, just a few feet away, the Lord filled their net and gave them victory that day. So when you get discouraged, don't you give up hope, for victory may be just a few feet away on the other side of the boat. Just a few feet away on the other side of the boat.
Once I was lost in sin, I had no peace within. Save my weary soul, I knew not how. But Jesus came to me, and by his grace I'm free. Now it's different, yes, it's oh, so different now.
He it's different now.
Yes, it's different
since
now.
Jesus saved my soul.
Since he saved my soul.
It's different
yes,
now.
It's different
since
now.
By his blood I'm whole.
By his blood I'm whole.
Oh, Satan had to flee when Jesus rescued me.
Now it's different.
Yes, it's
oh so different.
So glad to see you all return to church tonight. I'm glad that you're here. Let's stand together. Grab that hymn book there in front of you. 172, just over in the glory land. 172, just over in the glory land. Sing it out on that first verse with me.
I've a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land.
On that second verse, sing it out now.
I am on my way to those mansions fair, just over in the glory land, there to sing God's praise and his glory share, just over in the glory land, just over.
First, sing it out now.
With the blood washed throng, I will shout and sing, just over in the glory land. Glad hosannas to Christ the Lord and King, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, I'll join. Stand just over in the glory land.
Amen. Good evening. Welcome back to Bethel Baptist Church. Glad you all made it back tonight. If you weren't here this morning, can I just say you missed an excellent Sunday morning. Had a great message, great time here at church. If you're watching online, I see the camera, can't see you. Be here, all right? Be here. It's not the same, but let's go ahead and pray. Ask the Lord to bless our services. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for allowing us to be back this evening. What a privilege it is just being able to come to church Lord, being able to freely worship you, fellowship with other believers, just be encouraged before the week begins, Lord, starting tomorrow with all the secular places that people have to go and people they have to be around. Just thank you for the fellowship that we get on Sundays. We do ask that you just be with us tonight. Let us encourage each other, edify each other, Lord. Be with Pastor as he preaches. Just fill him with your spirit and your power and speak to our hearts. We ask it in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. As we continue singing Constantly Abiding, 211. Hymn 211. Constantly Abiding. On that first verse, sing it out together.
There's a peace in my heart that the world never gave. A peace it cannot take away. Though the trials of surround like a cloud, by the peace that has come here to stay. Constantly abiding, Jesus is mine. Constantly abiding, raptured he by.
Second verse as the last.
All the world seemed to sing of a Savior and King when peace sweetly came to my heart. Troubles all fled away and my night turned to day. Blessed Jesus, how glorious thou. Constantly abiding, Jesus is mine. Constantly abiding, rapture divine. He never leaves me lonely, whispers oh so kind.
As we continue singing, what a wonderful reminder that is. Let's remind me, dear Lord, now. 432 is what we'll sing. Remind me, dear Lord. 432. On that first verse, lift your voices with me.
The things that I love and am dear to my heart are just borrowed. And where?
may be seated. Anyone need a bulletin? You did not receive a bulletin this morning. I know some might have been in nursery or downstairs. If you did not receive a bulletin, just slip your hands up. Our ushers will get you one. It is the bulletin for the month of May. So please keep this in your Bible, or like some people, take a picture with your phone. But try and keep these dates. Mother's Day is next Sunday. Try and get your mother to come to church. If she does not already go to church somewhere, or maybe she comes in for a visit, I know it would be good for both of you. We'll have something special for all the moms next week. The mother-daughter activity is just a couple weeks away. You'll be going over to Swing Around Fun Town. I mean, that just sounds fun in the name, amen. So if you've never been there, it is a lot of fun. And you don't have to do all the games to go have a good time of fellowship. So ladies, please sign up. It'll be a good time, especially moms and daughters go together. You'll have a fun time over there. Our baby dedication is just a few weeks away. Again, I know we've got a few parents excited for that. Our tour group on the 28th, one of two tour groups I believe we'll be having this summer. But we'll have this one on the 28th of May. I hope you can be here to listen to them. The teen time that Sunday night. I think we're going to try a little bit of water balloon volleyball teenagers. It'll be a fun time as well. And then we have a lot planned in June. You can go ahead and just skim through it. We'll be announcing more of that coming up, placing some emphasis. But go ahead, look at the calendar, put these dates down where you'll see them, and plan on being there. Because if you don't plan, you won't go.
Thank you so much. We've had a few that jumped in already, jumped in for our Cardinals game, I saw, and registered. So you might want to get on top of that. That's June the 12th on a Monday evening. The game starts at 6:45, but we'll leave here at the church at 5:30 sharp. And so you can register that with the Church Connect app and in various different ways. So please, it costs us $5 per person. That just basically covers the cost of parking, really. For our vehicles, but we'd love to have a good group. We've got 50 tickets available, so that's the amount that can register after that. You're welcome to come. You're just going to have to buy your own ticket at a quite a bit steeper price than what we're charging. So we want to everyone that can be there to be there. It'd be a good time if you enjoy baseball, and we'll pray for some good weather during that time. The Cardinals are playing the Giants from San Francisco that night, and so it should be a good game. Looking forward to that very, very much. Thank you, all those who've signed up for the mother-daughter activity. Please continue to jump in on that. We need a good group of ladies there. And the best way to ensure we have continued good activities here at our church is to participate in them. And we want people to be involved, and we put a lot of work into those things. So let's get involved in those if we can. And thank you for all those who were able to come out yesterday for our visitation and soul-winning time and got to knock on several doors. The Lord was gracious enough to still give us good weather, even though everything was supposed to be just doom and gloom and rain and hail and frogs and all kinds of things flying through the air. So we didn't have that, so we're grateful for that. Got to go and knock on some doors, and that was a great time. If you can make it back out this coming Saturday at 10 o'clock, we would love to have you. It would be a great time together, I promise you that. And not only a time of just spreading the word of God and inviting people out to our church, but a time of fellowship as well, as you walk from door to door and getting to know. Sometimes you get paired up with somebody and you say, I don't know, I don't really talk to them during normal church times. Well, good. Get a chance to get to know somebody else as well, and hopefully get some training as well on how to talk to people and things like that. So if you can be here at 10 o'clock on Saturday, we'd enjoy having you. Wednesday nights, always a great time on Wednesday nights. As here in this auditorium, we have a time of prayer and Bible study. In prayer and Bible study time, we have a prayer list for our church. There's some people, they've been coming to our church for years. They have no idea that we have a prayer list. It just never shown up on a Wednesday night. And so get here on Wednesday nights. I know it's hard. I'll acknowledge that, but it is possible to make it here for church on Wednesday night. And some folks, they have to come in their work clothes. That's totally fine. Some slip in a few minutes late just because they're coming straight from work. And I'd rather you do that than just make the excuse and go home. So let's have a good crowd on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock as we pray for the needs of our church, as we study the Old Testament together. We've been going through the book of Judges the last few weeks and studying all the principles that God has for us out of that wonderful book. And so we're going through the Old Testament book by book this year and studying it and learning what we can from each book. So great opportunity for you to get a greater understanding of what God's Word has for you. And then obviously we have the Awana Kids Club on Wednesdays as well, going on during the same time. And so the children get the chance to learn from God's Word, memorize God's Word, do some crafts, play some games, have a good time together. And there's a lot of work that gets put into that ministry. So let's be here. Let's support it. It'd be great to have more folks here on a Wednesday night. And more prayer. Getting a hold of God and praying for the needs of our church. And for every person that's got an excuse why they shouldn't be here, there's another person who's here that had to overcome an excuse to get here. And so we've all got an excuse. We've all got an excuse. But let's be here for Wednesday night church, okay? 7 o'clock on Wednesday night. Looking forward to all these things that are coming up. Lots of events. Can I remind you, and Brother Tim did not ask me to say this at all, but camp is coming up for our teenagers, and they are trying their best to raise some money. They've done some different activities already, but we are still a few hundred dollars short that needs to be raised. If there's anyone, and I don't know who to ask about this, but if there's anyone who says, I'd be willing to maybe help out a young person. They're not lazy. It's not that they want a handout, but if you've got something that they could do to help them earn it, I'm sure that if you let them know or let Brother Tinnan know, he could help you out with that. But if there's someone who wants to just help sponsor and give a little bit towards the teen group to help a young person go to camp, we have a couple of new teenagers in our church this year that are desiring to go to camp, and we absolutely want them there. They're going to hear the preaching of God's word there. They're going to get encouraged by other young people who want to serve God with their life while they're there. Good music, good fellowship, good games, good preaching. And it's a great time, a formative time for them in their life. And I am so glad for all the Christian camps that I attended when I was a teenager and made many decisions while I was there. I was saved at a camp, and God really worked in my life during those times. So if you're interested, like I said, he didn't ask me to say this, but you could always drop something in the offering plate and just say sponsor teens or teen camp, whatever you want to put on there. We'll make sure it gets applied to our teen account, and that would help them. Maybe you don't have any, your teens are grown and gone now, and you're not paying any more teen camp fees anymore in your life, but maybe you could help another, the next generation to come up. And like I said, these are good kids. They're worthy of our investment. And they're not lazy either. They will work. I know they'll work to raise the money. But instead of having them stand in front of a Buckeyes 17 times before camp or wash half a billion cars or, you know, whatever it may be, maybe we can just try to help them out just a little bit along the way. So just consider that. Just consider that, if you would. It's been an exciting week as we've had work done around our buildings here, and looking forward to getting those done as quickly as we can. Please be in prayer for inspections that are coming already this week, and that God would allow things to pass by quickly, and we can continue to move on. Thank you for those who've already put in work towards our buildings. And we've had, I don't know, 10 or 12 men so far in different phases of this project who've already pitched in, and thank you for that. But there's more to come. I just want to let you know we've got a lot more to go on that. And but we're so grateful. God's been so good to our church and helped us with that. And so I didn't mention it this morning. I did in Sunday school, but I did in the main service. God has been helping us and blessing us financially in this already. And with already about our electrician came to me later in this week, and he said the original bid we gave you, I think, is way too high. And the wiring in the building is not nearly as complicated as I thought it was going to be. And he gave us a new bid on it, a new estimate of what he thinks the charges are going to be, which were about $5,000 less than what we originally quoted. And that's just a blessing. And like I said, that was unsolicited. We didn't lean on him and say, we're a church, brother. Can you help us out? You know, I didn't do any of that. God just spoke to that man, and he could have just pocketed. We agreed to the price that he originally gave us. And he could have just pocketed that profit and went about his way. But thank the Lord that God touched his heart to help us in that way. There's been several things that God's been doing the last couple of weeks in our church. I'm so grateful that. Can we please be faithful? Let's pray. Let's seek God's face concerning our ministry here. And let's be faithful to give, to support what we're trying to accomplish. We've got drywall that we still need to purchase. We've got insulation that we still need to purchase. We've got paint that we need to purchase. We've got additional furniture we're going to need to purchase for those buildings. The carpet's already bought, but we're going to have to put it in and install it. And there's a lot of things. We've got to pave the additional parking lot that's going in back there. And it's going to make, oh, just wait. It's going to make a huge difference in the back of our property to see that done. Then, if we're able to, if the season is right, we're going to have to do some landscaping back there as well. And so there's a lot of things still coming. Please just be faithful as God has blessed you to help our ministry. He has proven time and time, Brother Rick, year after year after year after year, that he can do what he needs to do through this church, through the people of this church. And so let's be faithful in that way. Ushers, you come forward. It's time for the offering. Thank you for being in God's house tonight. Are you excited to learn about more being an effective witness for Christ tonight? I think it'll be helpful to you tonight as well in the message. And looking forward to that as well. All right. Let's see. Oh, we switched it up, right? Brother DJ had to stay home tonight. They weren't feeling well, so he prayed this morning. So you thought you were going to get off the hook, Brother Schneider, but I'm going to come back to you anyways. Would you please pray for our offering? I'd like to sing a song for you tonight that is, I've sang it for several years. I heard it many, many years ago, and it's always, we had a lady in our church when I was growing up who actually sang this song, and then I had played that song for her to help her, and I did what I always do, I kept the music, because I like to collect music, and I love a good song especially, and considering the topic of our Sunday evening messages, it just goes right along with it. And it takes a little while to get into it, so just follow with me. But I promise that it's going somewhere. And I hope that you'll enjoy this very important principle from this song tonight. So.
When I think of Jesus, when I think of his birth, I can comprehend a love that would send our Savior from heaven to earth. When I think of that Holy One that came so tender and mild, God sent that day our sin debt to pay, and he sent it in the form of a child. How can I keep it a secret? How can I not share his love? How can I hide what he's done inside? How can I not share his love? How can I let lost men pass me by without sharing the gospel so free? How can I keep it a secret after all that he's done for me? And when I think of that lonely road that led to Calvary, the mocking, the scorn, the crown of thorns, and to think that he did it for me. And when I think of others living in sin day by day, they need to be free, but we hold the key. How can we leave them this way? How can I keep it a secret? How can I not share his love? How can I hide what he's done inside? How can I not share his love? How can I let lost men pass me by without sharing the gospel so free? How can I keep it a secret after all that he's done for me? How can I keep it a secret? What if someone had kept it from me?
That's a very convicting song. It goes very well. I had not planned on singing that tonight, but as I was getting ready for the message tonight, the Lord brought that song to my mind. Now, you guys help me out. I moved this lapel. I mean, it's in a different spot, so you let me know if it gives you some problems on how it's picking up, and I'd be happy to move it back to where it usually is, but I wanted to try. It feels a little different already, but you let me know. Just give me a thumbs down or something if it's not working out well, okay? And I'd be happy to move it. Matthew, they're right next to each other, so it's an easy mistake. Matthew 24, please, if you would. Better known as 2nd Psalm, the book of Matthew. Of course. Matthew 24, please, if you would. Take a look there. Matthew 24. I sincerely felt like the Lord was very much in the message this morning.
Amen. and he was helping me. I hope he was helping you,
Amen.
Helping me as I preached, and hopefully helping you as you listened. And I sincerely desire for that to be the case again tonight. Matthew 24, and look with me in verse number 4. Would you stand with me? So let's stretch one more time and honor God's word at Matthew 24 and verse number 4. And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled." What a great statement there for us. Can we just remember that now? In the day and age that we live in, you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. And Jesus' answer, just like it was this morning.
Right.
Don't worry about it.
Amen.
Don't be troubled about those things. For all those things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. The end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places, and all these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended. No kidding, huh? Shall many be offended. I almost see, there's major theological discussions that take place over this portion of Scripture. Was it for them in that moment? Was it for us and when we live now? Was this a continual timeline that God is giving us here as things are progressing? I feel like definitely for sure we're living in the time that many shall be offended.
Yes.
And shall betray one another. Hey, call our hotline. Report this. Someone was not wearing a mask. Report them. And there's a lot of that going on these days. Shall betray one another and shall hate one another. Hate comes very quickly in the day and age that we live in now. It doesn't take much to get someone to hate you. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. And that is really the launching point for this message tonight, is verse number 12. It's very easy to apply all of these things to what we would call the world, or the unsaved, or the unbeliever. But I can say that verses 10... 11 and 12 are universal for both believer and unbeliever.
Right.
I have seen this type of attitude. I've seen this type of behavior from both groups of people. And I want you to notice in verse number 12, for us, let's just consider us for a moment. I prayed this at the end of our choir practice this afternoon. God, would you use me to speak, use us all to use the Holy Spirit to help me as I speak, use the Holy Spirit to speak to every single one of us individually, and that we would take heed to what's being said for us alone. This is for me. God, as you speak to my heart, this is for me. It's not them. Oh, they need that. That will help them. For me. So let's apply this to ourselves tonight then, okay? In verse number 12, and because iniquity shall abound. Iniquity is one of several names for, let's just call it, good old-fashioned what? Sin, right? Iniquity is a form of sin that many would look at as saying iniquity is a consistent, unrepentant sin. Something that is in your heart that you have purposefully allowed to remain between you and God. You know it's wrong. There's no real ambiguity there. There's no gray area there. But you've just refused to get victory over it and forsake it. And he says, because this iniquity, because this sin shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. I would like to apply this directly to the topic of being an effective witness tonight, because so much of what we're trying to do to be a soul winner has to be generated from an attitude of, I am choosing to love people.
Amen.
Yeah. I love them enough to tell them the truth.
Amen. Yeah.
I love them enough to give them an opportunity for salvation. Yeah. But I don't know them. It's irrelevant.
That's right. Yeah.
Because God loves them, I will love them.
Amen. Yes.
Because God loved them enough to die for them, I will love them enough to tell them about that. See, there's a generation that comes from the heart outward, and that has to be formulated in love. Because love will overcome the resistance. Love will overcome the scoffing. Love will overcome the inconvenience.
Amen.
Love will overcome the rejection. Look, we've all seen it. If you really care about somebody, maybe there's a young man who's just really smitten by this young lady. I mean, he thinks that she hung the moon. You know what I mean? And you know, if you're consistent and boy, you really want to have a date with that young lady, she may tell you no once. That won't stop him. They may ask again. They won't let the rejection stop them. Until eventually maybe a court order does or whatever it is that gets them to stop. But, well, it's raining right now. I'm not going to ask her out on a date. Fooey on that, man. Ask her out, soaking wet. Well, you know, I'm kind of tired after work. She's there. She's available. What are we doing here? When you want something, when you have a love for it, a passion for it, you're going to overcome all those things. So before we sit down and say, all right, let me tell you how to knock on the door. Let me tell you how to introduce yourself, introduce the church. All right, let's do this verse and then this verse and then ask them this question. Before we get into some of the nitty gritty of how to physically deliver the message, the motivation has to be properly founded.
Amen.
What is generating your desire to go has to be pure and has to be right. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. It's just, you're not going to find yourself consistently wanting to witness.
Right.
It's not only a love for the people, and I'll have you sit in just a moment. It's not just a love for the people, but it's also a love for the God
True.
Who tells you to go. So this idea of being a witness is very, very, very much shrouded in this idea of love. And Jesus himself tells us as we get closer and closer to those end times that the love of many shall wax cold. We don't want to fall into that category, do we?
No.
Do we want that to be our testimony as a church?
No.
They were a cold church. Let's look at this tonight as we look at the topic of the soul winner's heart. What does the soul winner's heart look like? How can I develop a heart for soul winning, Pastor? How can I? You've been pretty passionate about it. I mean, you have not stopped. I think you've mentioned it in every message for the last year.
Amen.
How do I get consumed with that?
Right.
Yesterday, I was out running an errand after soul winning was over, and after I stayed here at the church and did some work and studied for a while and did some different things, and I had to go out and run a couple errands, and I was at a store, and I hopped out of my car to go run in, and I was reminded of the very important, and I'll probably mention this again during this study time over the next several weeks, but I was reminded of the principle I was given many years ago: the people who pass out tracts are the ones who have them on them. And so I turned around and I went back to my car, and I went back into my car, and I reached out, I have tracks in my car, and I grabbed a couple and I threw them in my back pocket. I said, all right, Lord, I said, I have them on me. So if you want me to pass them out, you're going to have to put somebody by my path. And so I went in the store and was walking around. I was like any large department store. Everything you need is either on this one end of the store, and then you have to walk over to this completely other end of the store to get it. And so I walked the entire store. I did a complete lap around that store while I was there. And there was no opportunity And I'm not recommending that you do this. I don't want us to be that type of church per se, but I was done. I was checking out, and I said, all right, Lord, there wasn't anybody to talk to. And he said, well, what good is that track if you just walk back to your car and it's still in your pocket? I didn't know what else to do, so I just took it out of my back pocket and I set it on the little area right by the self-checkout. I just set it down there. Will somebody take it? Well, somebody's going to take it. I'm not going to go check this afternoon and see if it's still sitting there. I imagine it's gone. Say, well, did that do anything? I don't know. And you don't know either, to be quite honest. So don't judge me. I won't judge you. I don't think that, I don't want us to go around and put them on all the cars and stuff. Let's be careful with that kind of stuff. But maybe God loves somebody in that store. Maybe God loves an employee who's going to come by and make sure there's enough bags at the self-checkout area, and they'll see that and pick it up. And I made sure I left it face up, so it said, Discover God's Love.
Right. Amen.
On the top. What will God do with it? I don't know. I may never know in this lifetime. But I brought it in, and I didn't want to leave empty-handed. Amen. So I made sure I set it down somewhere. And that's because, you know what? Somebody's got to love the people in Fenton. That's where I was. And someone's got to get the gospel into Fenton. And I don't think I'm the hero to do that. But I just feel like God wanted someone to know about him that day. And so I did everything I possibly could to get the message out in that moment. But it comes with a heart of love. And I don't want to let the sin of this time, the iniquity of this time, allow my heart to grow cold for people. So how do we work on our heart and get the soul winner's heart? Let's talk about that tonight. Heavenly Father, would you please bless this time? Help me to be very clear with the people and formulate good thoughts to help them follow along. May your word speak to all of us now. Use me, please, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for standing. Please be seated. Did I tell you tonight that keeping a tender heart is one of the most essential labors in soul winning?
Amen.
It is an absolutely pivotal, key, foundational trait for you to have. Keeping a tender heart. As we live in a very wicked world, and we are constantly, constantly introduced to sin, tempted to sin, and in many cases in our own lives, participating in sin. It will push against and war against and sear the conscience of our heart and mind against the very real fact that while we are secure in our place with Christ, for many of the billions of people on this planet, their very eternity hangs in the balance.
Right.
And as we become self-absorbed with our own issues, our own problems, it's very easy to lose sight of the great need.
Yes, amen.
Very true, very true.
And our sin clouds us from that fact. Our sin causes us to be very selfish, although can we say with certainty that all sin is selfish? All sin is pride. It's all rooted in pride. Every single sin, doesn't matter what it is, you can name it, its root is back to pride in the sense that we believe that we are above God's law. And we can do whatever we want regardless of how God feels about it. Every sin is pride, and every sin is selfishness. I'm choosing myself over God. And that sin in our heart can cause the love that should be inside of us for the loss to just diminish and diminish and diminish.
Yes.
The issue in many of our modern churches and the fact that they have given up on soul winning and given up on having clear presentations of the gospel regularly in their ministries,
right,
are not so much an issue of that they don't even believe in the gospel. It's just the simple fact that they've become so distracted in other areas of their life and they've become so self-centered and self-pleasing in their church philosophy that they have abandoned what has become an eternal work of service. They don't mind raking leaves in a park somewhere, but they won't go to a park and pass out a track.
Right.
Because as much as they don't want to admit it, community service and having their church's name in the paper is very self-serving.
Right.
Such and such Assembly of the Rock, Church of Our Redeemer, raked leaves or painted lines on the Little League field or gave out some food. And those aren't bad things. They're not horrible things. And if our church, if there's ever some opportunity or place, I'm not against it per se. But there's a difference between that and, look, the leader is not going to follow us out on Saturday morning and go door to door with us and say, hey, Bethel Baptist Church cares enough about our area to tell them the truth of the gospel. There's no paparazzi following us.
Right.
There's no articles in the paper. There's no radio people that are calling us out and giving us a shout out. There's Fox and NBC and CBS and ABC from St. Louis are not coming down to say, you've got to see what this church in Otto is doing. You know, nobody's doing that. It's very selfless. Your Saturday is important. I do not disagree with that. Can we just all get that out of the way, please?
Right. Amen.
Your pastor does not disagree with the fact that you need free time.
Yes. Amen.
Okay, good. We're all on the same page.
Yes.
Amen.
Your pastor does not disagree with the fact that Saturdays are awesome when you don't have to work. And we'd all just like to stay in our PJs and eat some Fruit Loops and watch some cartoons.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Or Reese Puffs or Frosted Mini Wheats or Captain Crunch or whatever it is you're into. I agree.
Yes.
I agree. Whether it's the Saturday or if I plug in any other time, pastor's moving soul winning to Tuesday nights. Tuesday nights, you know, we normally have such and such. I know you're not at work anymore. You're home. Isn't it dinner time, Pastor? I understand all of it. I really do. But going soul winning, whether it's at a given time, an established time, an organized time, or where it's whether it's running back to your car just to grab a track to take in with you, just in case.
Amen. Yes.
They're selfless acts.
Yes.
Now, I don't tell you that story to, oh, look, Pastor, look, he's on fire for the souls. No, 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 no. I am just trying to obey God's voice.
Amen.
The last few weeks in my life, and I hate to say this to my own shame, but the last few weeks of my life, I have centered and done everything I possibly can do, more so even. Say, how does the revival affect all of us? Well, this is my effect of the revival. I have done everything I possibly can to try to be obedient, no matter how ludicrous the request may be. No matter, I can't see the reasoning why, or this is inconvenient, God. If something comes into my mind that is somewhat remotely spiritual, I am just chalking it up to saying, that's not my flesh. That must be the Holy Spirit. Yes. And in the last 2 weeks of my life spiritually, I have seen more blessings.
Yes.
In my own personal life and in the ministry of our church, just trying to be obedient to His Word. And you know what? A lot of nobody sees it. We don't do it for a pat on the back. We don't do it for a news story. Soul winning is a selfless act. Meaning, boy, it has to be driven by love.
Amen.
Because more than likely, at least here below on this earth, you're not going to get anything out of it. Unless maybe it's a really hot day and pastor feels bad for you. He says, let's stop it on the run and get slushies for everybody. You know what I mean? You're not really going to get much out of it. Unless it's a Super Saturday soul winning or something and we've got danishes and donuts. You're not going to get anything tangible out of it. I know I'm a real bad salesman tonight. I know that. But that's kind of the point. It's selfless. And it, just like all selfless things, whether it's a soldier giving his life for the country that he loves, it has to be driven out of love. We have a love for freedom, we have a love for America, and so we have people who are willing to lay down their life to protect that. The selfless act comes out of love for something. Love for duty, love for that branch of the military, whatever it is, I guarantee you trace it back, there was love somewhere for something. They did it for their own personal family to make sure the commies didn't get to them. Whatever it may be, Any selfless act can be traced back to love.
Amen.
Jesus dying on the cross for us, that did not serve him in any way. He was debased from that. He was tortured for that. It was selfless on his part. Oh, but he gained us. Exactly. What kind of win is that?
Right.
He gained a bunch of sinners.
Right.
But he did it because he loved us.
Amen.
He died for us because he loved us. Whether it's a soldier, whether it's our Savior, whether it's a husband or a wife doing something for their family that they get no recognition for, whether it's a mother and a father doing without again, they haven't bought a new pair of socks in 20 years. You know, they just keep their socks are turning into toeless sandals, you know, as they work their way back. Dad hasn't got a new suit. Mom hasn't had a new dress in eons. But guess what? Every year for Easter, those kids got new clothes. Every time at school, they've got new shoes. And the parenting magazine is not coming by your house to say, Parent of the Year Award.
Right.
In fact, many people don't even see it. They don't even notice. Even other parents don't notice. Even though you're all quietly going through the same phase of life together. Well, why do you do it? Well, I love my kids.
Right.
Every selfless act can be traced back to love. And so here, by the words of our Savior, he tells us, look, in the end times, one of the main issues that we're going to be facing is that the love of many shall wax cold. If we willingly choose to not tell people about Jesus Christ, we are signaling that we don't love those people at all. We could care less about this world. Well, I don't really feel that way. You can say it all you want.
Right.
But as I sang tonight, they need to be free, but we hold the key.
Right.
Amen.
How can I leave them this way? It goes back to love. And the love that I have for those people, even though I don't even know their name, it drives me to want to tell them about the greatest thing, as Brother Cody sang so wonderfully this morning, the greatest thing that ever happened to me, the greatest of all miracles,
right,
was when Jesus saved me.
That's right.
Amen.
In Psalm 39, verse number 3, we know this famous verse here from David when he says, my heart was hot within me. And while I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue. And he goes on to begin praising the Savior after this. We see the importance of how we dwell upon things and think about things, how it affects our heart. It affects our heart. You say, Pastor, my heart is, there's wickedness in there. I need to change it. I need to fix it. How do I start? Well, you're feeding your heart by what you're thinking about.
Amen.
And David said, I've learned to affect my heart by what I muse upon, what I think upon. If my heart needs to develop a love for the loss of this world, then I need to engage my mind maybe differently than I have been using it. I need to think about some things differently. I need to consider some things differently in my life. If I'm struggling to find the motivation that I need, and I'm not saying that we don't all struggle at some point, that we all have weak times, but I'm saying if you desperately are struggling, God, to find this motivation that the pastor is telling me, and I know it's there, and I know I need to, but man, it's just so hard to get going with this. If you're struggling to develop that love inside of you, let's help you with this, to develop the soul winner's heart by musing on the right things.
Amen. Amen.
The mind is a gateway to motivating the heart. It's a gateway. Every person who's ever bought that house, bought that car, maybe there was a car that you've always wanted. How did it start? You saw it somewhere. You saw it in the magazine. You started thinking about it. Just as you start thinking about it, lo and behold, there goes one down the road right past you.
Yeah.
And you're thinking about it some more. I can plant something in your mind right now. I can give you an image. I mean, we can just talk about anything. tacos. Can you smell that seasoned beef? Taco seasoning in it, that's one of the greatest introductory smells of a meal. Just some brown hamburger with some taco seasoning in it. Can you hear the crunch of the knife going through the lettuce? And you know that you're going to get that warm seasoned beef with that crisp, cold lettuce. Can you hear that block of cheese going over that grater? Knowing you have that fresh shredded cheese on there, or maybe the sound of the bag tearing open and just dumped into a bowl. If you got the time, you know. Can you hear the pop of the salsa jar? Can you smell that acidic tomato smell? Or maybe you like mango chili. Spicy, not so spicy. Maybe you're picante only on tacos, nothing too chunky. Can you smell that? You can taste it a little bit, can't you? Maybe the whipped cream makes its appearance. Dropping a big old plop on those tacos there. So you bite into it, you get the crunch of the shell, you get the seasoned beef, you get that crisp lettuce, you get that little tartness of the sour cream, you get the saltiness of the cheese, the acidic tomato taste of the salsa. Well, it's time for an invitation. Who wants tacos? Yeah. The rest of you are lying. I know you are. Or you don't like tacos. In that case, maybe you're the ones who need to get saved tonight. But it doesn't matter what it is. I can plug anything into your mind. And if it's descriptive enough and you're hungry enough, or whatever it may be, the mind is a gateway to the heart. And your wanter of your heart is fueled by the musings of the mind. Amen. You're going to want the things that you're thinking about. In this scripture, we read how sin hinders the spread of God's love. God's love is going to be hard to be found because so many people are going to be selfish in their mindset. That it's going to be difficult to find the unselfish love of God. As our lives become more distracted and sinful, a love for the lost can no longer be found. As we get distracted, I'm a firm believer in the 21st century, the absolute greatest tool of the devil is busyness.
Yes.
Every activity must be acted upon. Every game must be gone to. Well, we've got... It's not even junior varsity. It's something below that. And it's my third cousin's niece's, clarinet recital. And you haven't seen them in 15 and a half years. But I got invited to it on a whim. And Pastor, I'm sorry. It's such and such time. I can't go. The devil is plaguing us as Christians. Not with even overall sinful activity, but just so much busyness that we have become distracted. You say, well isn't going to my third cousin's aunt's wife's niece's clarinet recital, isn't that selfless? I mean, I hate the clarinet, Pastor. But for some reason, you chose that over telling people about Christ. So you can tell me that you hate the clarinet. Those people haven't spoken to you. Well, maybe I'll win them. Okay. We'll play a circular argument game then. But we have grown cold in our love for the lost, and busyness has become really the main enemy of our opportunity to display God's love to other people. We've become distracted.
Right.
And as we get more and more distanced from the gospel, we're not only not speaking it as much as we should be, we're not hearing it as much as we should be, and so our attitude towards the Lord is affected in that way. Listen, church, if we're not hearing the gospel regularly, even if you don't need it, you are saved. But the fact that you are not hearing the gospel regularly, and the fact that you are not yourselves preaching or speaking the gospel regularly in your own life, it affects your attitude towards God. Because that is the central focus for our very relationship with God. It's due to the gospel. It's because of the gospel. It's the central theme. I have no relationship with God without the gospel. And if I am refusing in my own life to be around the gospel, and I'm refusing in my own life to speak or preach the gospel to other people and witness in that way, I am removing a very central hub of my relationship with God. And you wonder why we're lacking in the love of God in our life. What is the love of God? Well, the love of God is best represented by His giving of Himself for the lost mankind. And our ability to love God leads us to want to share that love with other people. But when I don't hear about the gospel, I don't speak the gospel, I'm never around the gospel, my love for God can grow dim. Because I'm missing a linchpin, a key hub of my very connection to God Himself.
Yes.
Has been muddied, has been blurred, because the gospel is not anywhere in focus in my life at all. You follow me, church?
Amen.
My love for lost people is driven by what I think about. And if I'm never around the gospel, how am I thinking about the Savior? I'm not thinking about His love. I'm not thinking about His sacrifice. And farther we drift away from the gospel, the harder and harder it is to see its importance. The harder and harder it is to become motivated to even want to tell anyone else about it.
Right.
Because we're so busy musing on other things. The gospel is, forget about the rearview mirror, it's well back over the horizon. Let me give you a few truths to think about tonight to help you develop the soul winner's heart. The soul winner must first of all think about Calvary. How do I develop a soul winner's heart, Pastor? You must think about Calvary. You must consider what He's done for us. As I sang it tonight, and when I think of that lonely road that led to Calvary, the mocking, the scorn, the crown of thorns, and to think that He did it for me. You have to muse on Calvary. You have to consider it. In fact, it might not be a bad exercise for us to consider or talk or mention or maybe even read verses concerning Calvary. Every single time you feel the need to preach the gospel, maybe if you're struggling to find that need inside your heart, maybe I need to spend some time reading about Calvary again and considering what Jesus did for me. Why should we think about Calvary? And why does the soul winner consider Calvary every single time they want to be a witness for Christ? Is because the persons you talk to behind that door, behind that register, at the bank, at the gas pump, wherever it may be, at your home, at work, wherever you can witness, those persons you will talk to were purchased with His blood at Calvary.
Amen. Yes.
Calvary was for them. Jesus died for them.
Yes.
How do I develop a love for those people when you realize that God loves them just as much as He loves you?
That's right.
And He died for them just as much as He died for you. You must be thinking about Calvary. How can I keep it a secret? How can I not share His love? When you consider what He did for you on Calvary, and then you remember that He was not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Right.
You must consider Calvary. You must consider the fact that God thought their soul was worth enough to suffer. That person you look at that maybe has their body marked up. Maybe they have enough metal hanging off their body to make a TSA metal detector go haywire. And they look different than you. And their life is different. And they've had some hard times. And maybe you can smell something that you know they've been doing something they ought not to do, whether it be on their clothes or on their breath or coming from the house, or you hear some music or you see something on a television. I can't tell you how many times I've been sitting in the living room of somebody trying to win them to the Lord while I purposely make sure I don't look at their TV by the wickedness that's on it. I can't look over there. But when you look at those people and you knock on the door and they say, "Oh, I go to such and such church, not really interested," Jesus thought their soul was worth enough to suffer.
Amen.
To have his, literally have his insides ripped out. To be mocked, to be beaten, to be spit upon. To be laughed at. To be denied, to be forsaken. He thought they were worth it. "Well, they were mean to me." Well, not as mean as they were to Jesus. How can I love those people? Well, we need to think about how Christ loved them. He thought they were worth it. How do I motivate myself, Pastor? You need to think about Calvary more. Amen. How do I develop the soul winner's heart? Well, maybe you need to think about death. The soul winner considers the reality of death. The fact that we would stop on a Saturday or a Tuesday or a Thursday or a random Monday or whatever it may be to tell somebody about Jesus Christ is because death exists. It is inevitable for every single fleshly human being that's here. Your body will not last forever. And for that person on the other side of the door, one day they will have their last opportunity to hear the gospel. And death will come for them. You don't know when it is, and they don't know when it is either.
Right.
But one day, just like that elderly man that we knocked on his door yesterday, who was a devout Catholic, and I think that Jim was a good man. I think that he was good to people. He was very good to us. He didn't even know us. He was kind. He listened. I don't even know if he agreed with everything I was saying, but he never interrupted me. He never made fun of what I was saying. He was not condescending towards me, even though he was maybe 1.5 to almost 2 times my age. He was kind. And he listened. He talked about his life. He talked with us about our lives. He was a good man, but wasn't sure he was going to heaven. He thought he was doing everything he could do, and he was hoping that God thought it was enough. That was literally his whole basis for salvation. I think I'm going, but I hope God feels the same way. That's what he said. Grew up being told that just being good enough and doing your best and being on the straight and narrow was the only, that's the best you can do as a human being to get to heaven. That's what he believed. That man is much closer to the end than he is to the beginning. Death will come for him. And yesterday I said to him, "Look, God loves you. He wants you to be sure of your salvation. He died for you. He shed his blood for you so you can have forgiveness for your sins." Why did I tell him that? Because death is real. And yesterday, I might have been his last opportunity. We must think about death. It's inevitable, and it's also final. The opportunity to choose ends at death. God gives us one life, one chance to accept his Son, and after that, there's no more opportunities. We must consider Calvary. We must consider death. How do I develop a heart for people, Pastor? What are you thinking about? Are you thinking about all that you need to get done on a Saturday? Or are you thinking about the fact that Jesus died for some people in this area? Are you thinking about the fact that those people will die one day and their eternity will be sealed in that moment? What are you thinking about? Number three, not only should we think about death, we should be thinking about heaven. The heart of the soul winner has considered heaven. And I don't have time to go into all the beauties and splendors of heaven. I'm hoping one day, not in the too long future, in our church, we'll have a wonderful series about heaven. We'll celebrate heaven together. We'll talk about heaven. We'll learn about heaven. And that'll be a great time. That'll be a fun thing to preach, really. Because I get to preach on all positive stuff. Man, what a great turn of events that would be. But we've got to consider heaven as well. Why? Heaven is a legitimate option for every person. For every person, no matter what they've done, no matter where they've came from, what their background is, right. How much money in the bank, heaven is an option for every person.
Amen. That's right.
They have the opportunity to spend eternity with God.
Amen.
And it all comes down to one simple decision. But they, just like every single one of us, will be greatly, immensely aided if someone would just lead them to that decision. If someone would clearly give them the facts and say, God loves you. Do you want to accept? If Jesus was willing to accept you right now, exactly the way you are, would you be willing to accept them? If someone could just lead them to that, how many people would just say, yes?
Amen.
Yes. And heaven is a real option for them. There are scores of people that have died and found that their eternity will be without God. When I believe that they probably would have said yes if someone would have just told them. And according to the book of Romans, we're without excuse. Even if they don't have a gospel witness to directly tell them, the Bible says that God has given them enough within their heart and within nature to display to them their need for God and their need for salvation. God has said that to us very clear because it's hard to rectify that in our mind. That they will still die into the sin curse just like everyone else will be. But I believe that there are scores that are in hell tonight that could be in heaven. If someone just considered that, that's a real option for them. And if I tell somebody, they may just choose God. Yes, there'll be some that will say no. There'll be some that will not listen. But as that wonderful song we sing says, there's the value of the one.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Where heaven will be a real possibility. To not give them a chance at heaven is to condemn them to hell. I'm not saying that you committed the sin that sends them to hell. They committed that on their own, and they live under the sin curse by their own responsibility. But what I am saying is that if you're not even willing to go and tell them, you are contributing to their downfall. You, by association, are complicit in the fact that they will not see God in a perfect body one day. Well, I could tell. I'm kind of busy. I don't really think I could go out. Okay. So whose responsibility is it then? Which one of the 38 will call the police, like we mentioned last week?
Right.
Whose responsibility is it? To not tell them about God's wonderful gift is the ultimate act of selfishness.
Yes.
You've received the gift. You enjoy the bounties of the gift.
That's right.
And to not tell anyone else about it. Would we say that a doctor was extremely selfish if they had found a legitimate and permanent cure for cancer and chose to keep it a secret and not tell anybody? How would you feel, some of you in here who've maybe lost a loved one to cancer? If you knew that secretly in some lab somewhere, a doctor or a scientist had come up with a permanent, legitimate cure, and they didn't tell anybody about it, how would you feel? Would you become violently angry at that person? I think you might. If they were standing in front of you and you found that out, and you would say, what do you mean you didn't tell anybody? Right. Your first question would be, why? Yeah. Why? Well, I was busy. What do you mean you're busy? Well, I had a lot going on. I wasn't feeling super great. You mean you let your cold stop you from saving my wife, from saving my husband, from saving my child, from saving my father, from saving my mother, my aunt, whatever it may be? You let your cold stand in the way of that, you'd have to restrain yourself. That's the ultimate act of selfishness. To have the opportunity to present them with the cure and heaven be their destination and not say anything. The soul winner has their heart because they've been musing not only about heaven but also about hell. Hell is a real place. Hell is a real place with real fire.
Yes, sir.
With real torment. It is a real place created out of the judgment of God for those who've rejected Him. It is not a limbo place. It's not an opportunity for redemption. There is no redemption in hell. There is no salvation from hell. It is as permanent as heaven for the lost sinner.
Yes.
And the soul winner's heart is developed because they've considered hell. Many years ago, maybe some of you have heard this story. How many of you have heard the name John R. Rice before? Dr. John R. Rice? Many in here. Good. And that's a good thing. He was a great man. The original editor and founder of the Soul Lord magazine, wrote several books on prayer. His book, Prayer Asking Receiving, is an excellent book on prayer. He was a preacher mainly in the 60s and 70s. He passed away, I believe, in 1980 or 82. But he was riding a horse at the Bill Rice, John Rice, not related in any way, but the same last name, but the Bill Rice Ranch, which was very famous and popular in those days. And they were riding some horses together, Dr. John R. Rice and several other preachers, and a younger pastor kind of got his horse going and got up next to John R. Rice. He said, Dr. Rice, why do we go out and do soul winning and go door to door and tell people about Jesus? Aren't there other ways to do it? Why is it so important that we do this? He thought he had a real great question, you know, that this was some, he's going to have some deep theological discussion with Dr. John R. Rice. Dr. John R. Rice, as he spoke, he didn't have a big booming voice, kind of gruff. If you ever heard a recording of him, and kind of deep, and he was up in years at this point. He said something kind of under his breath, and the young preacher didn't hear it. Dr. Rice, did you hear what I said? I said, can you help me understand? Why do we go door to door? Why do we go soul winning? Why do we do these things? Why do you preach on this? Why do you write about this? Why do you have men in your paper talk about the importance of us being on fire for God and telling people about the Lord? And why is it so important? And he finally looked over at the young man and he said, is there a hell? That was his answer. Well, no, you're not answering my question, Dr. Rice. I'm wondering if this is important for us now in the modern church age to go door to door and to tell people about Jesus. Son, I said, is there a hell? If there's a hell, then it's important. If there's no hell, then do whatever you want to do. Why do we go out and we tell people? It's because as beautiful as heaven is, hell is equally as horrendous.
Yes.
The soul winner's heart is molded by their thinking about hell. If no one tells them, they will spend an eternity away from God and out of His will. Hell is not what God wants for them. In fact, God has done everything he possibly can to keep them out. But the one thing he cannot do is force them to choose him. But he does know that we as human beings have a tendency to believe the eyewitness and the testimony of our peers. So he calls upon us to go and tell them. It's amazing that the rich man had one desire. When he realized that he could not get water from Lazarus because of the great gulf fixed between them, what was the cry of the rich man? What was he consumed with? Well, go back and tell my family. Tell them. When the reality of hell was apparent, the idea of going out and witnessing just really wasn't too big of a deal. It wasn't as inconvenient as we thought it was. Right. A soul winner's heart is formed by musing on not only Calvary, not only death, not only heaven, not only hell, but also the Great Commission itself. In just a few pages from here, in Matthew 28, if you want to turn with me, I'm almost done. In Matthew 28, and look with me at the Great Commission here in verse number 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. There's two simple things I find here about the Great Commission. And it's not only a commission, it is a command, by the way.
Amen.
It's a command. God said to go. He wasn't just speaking to those 11 men, he was speaking to us. It was for all who believed in him to go and preach the gospel. It was the last charge that the general gave to his troops. And the Great Commission, it is a command under God's power. You see that in verse number 18? All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore.
Amen.
This is a command that God has given to us because he has power to help influence.
Yes. Amen.
Because he has power to progress his gospel forward. He says, I'll give you the power. I'll give you the help. Pastor, I'm struggling to figure out, can I go? I'm so afraid. I'm so worried about how this thing's going to go. God says, don't worry about those things. I have all power. I will give you what you need if you just go.
Amen.
It's a command that is given under God's power. God is not giving us an unfulfillable command here. God is not giving us a command that is beyond our capability. He says, I will give you what you need. I have all power.
Amen.
And I will help you. It is a command under God's power in verse number 19. And it is a command to go. I said this yesterday, not even realizing I was previewing the message for tonight, but the most important word in the Great Commission is go. Go. He didn't say wait. He didn't say sit for them to come to you. Now, look, there are some ministries that are out there. It's kind of a big thing. And if I have some friends who are doing this ministry and you ever see it, I promise you I'm for you and what you're doing. But there's been some great talk now. These ministries of we set up a little kiosk and we give out some free things and we just wait for people to come to us. And when they're there, we'll give them the gospel. I do not find that anywhere in Scripture. I do not find that Peter, James, and John were just sitting around the temple saying, anybody want to hear about Jesus? Just come find us.
Right.
Every single time the gospel is preached, they were sent, or they went, or they were on their way, or they decided to go into the synagogue and teach. It was an act of, I will reach out. I'm not waiting for the world to come to me. I'm going to go to the world.
Amen.
Because that's the command. The command is to go.
Amen.
We don't want to support missionaries that say, well, when we feel like the people of whatever country want to hear about it, they'll raise the money and they'll fly over here and come and find the truth. Man, can we, let's vote on them right now. No, we want people who are willing to go.
Amen.
They'll meet them where the need is. But as we applaud them and thank them for their sacrifice, what about here?
Yes.
Are we going to go where they are? At least here, they're just down the street. At least here, they might be where we already are, and it just happens to be that we come together and God provides an opportunity. You don't have to fly across an ocean. They're a few-minute drive away. You don't have to uproot your entire family. You don't have to raise your kids and homeschool them on a mission field. You don't have to learn first aid and self-defense for your family because no one's coming to help. You can do it from the comfort of your own SUV, your own car, the comfort of our own nice new shuttle bus. You can walk along our beautifully paved streets sometimes around here. You can walk along a nice concrete sidewalk and knock on a nice well-built door. There's really not much sacrifice to it. Your pastor's even enough of a wimp that, man, if it gets below 32 degrees, he'll cancel the whole thing. Because I've tried to be as considerate as I can. Oh, is that a raindrop? Got to go to apartments today. I'm as considerate as I possibly can be, but God says we ought to go. If we're not going, we're not obeying. I don't know how else to put it. If we're not going, we're not obeying. Going can take many forms. I mean, going can be physical. Going can just be, well, I'm getting out the... I can't walk. If someone who comes into our church and they have no legs, we don't have a wheelchair lift on our shuttle bus. There's not much I can do to help them. Now, they may be able to drive to a neighborhood and get themselves out and go along. You know, that'd be tough. There's a lot of really hilly neighborhoods in our area and a lot of uneven driveways, and that may be hard. But they say, you know, Pastor, you know what I can do? I can start making phone calls. Hey, I'm just calling from Bethel Baptist Church, and I just wanted the opportunity to talk to you. Is there someone you'd like to pray with you and talk to you about Jesus today? I know of people that have done that throughout the years. That's how they go. They're reaching out. At least they're not waiting for people to come to them. They're going. Or they'll stand somewhere if they can. They can't walk very far, but they'll stand somewhere and pass out tracts. When I was in Hawaii a few weeks ago, the street that we were walking down, there were two separate groups of Jehovah's Witnesses just sitting there on the sidewalk with a little display, just passing out literature as people went by. Wasn't much to it, but they were going. They didn't sit inside their kingdom hall and say, well, if people want to know what we have to say, they'll come and visit us. They at least were outside and finding people. They were going. Going can take different forms. I'm not saying that every single person has to keep up with the young people in our church running from door to door. I wouldn't care if someone came to pastor. I got about five doors into me and I am wiped out. That's five more than you knocked on last week.
Amen.
Five more people got the gospel, whether it's preached to them verbally or they got it on a track. That's five more than last week. The Great Commission is a command to go. So Pastor, as we finish up, I've got about 2 minutes and I'm done. How do we keep the fire then? Pastor, you're stirring me. I'm getting it. I understand what you're saying now. God's working on my heart, and I've been trying. Maybe you have been going more than you used to. Maybe you just started going for the very first time this year. Pastor, how do I keep the fire? There's some men, Brother Rick and myself and others, we've been going for decades now. How do you still get excited about it on Saturday morning? Can I tell you, number one, that's not always true. But I go anyway, because it's a command. But how do you get on a bus and say, hey, we're going to go knock on some doors. Let's go tell people about Jesus today. How do you keep the fire inside? Number one, very simply, we keep the fire, first of all, by going. Go. If you begin to slack off, the fire will burn out. Well, I don't feel like adding any logs to the fire today. Well, the fire will burn out. Whether you feel like chopping wood or not, wood's got to go on the fire. It starts by just going. Good times, bad times, good weather, bad weather. As long as you're not contagious. I've got a headache. Man, I've knocked so many doors with a headache. I don't even know if I can count how many. I've twisted my ankle while out soul winning, and I just kept going. Amen. Oh, I'm here. As long as there's no bones sticking out or anything, I think I'm okay. I'll deal with it when I get home. We just kind of go. How do you keep the fire? Go. Number two, this is deep, folks. Go often. How do you keep the fire? Go often. Your mind is a gateway to the heart. Feed that mind with the musings of going and speaking the gospel. There have been times, I can tell you, church, I've been so discouraged, frustrated with ministry, with my own life, with something that's going on. I always feel better when I'm out soul winning. 100% of the time.
Amen.
I'm not kidding. I'm not just preaching. I'm actually telling you the truth now. 100, you didn't get that. Which is good, I guess. You didn't know. 100% of the time. Amen. When I was discouraged, when I was lonely, when I was feeling sorry for myself, and I went and I said, God, I want to be obedient to you. Help me while I'm out. I felt better afterwards than when I went in.
Amen. Amen.
God restored my soul. He encouraged me. He blessed me for obedience, whatever it may be. I always felt better afterwards.
Amen.
Go and go often. Number three, pass out tracts constantly.
Amen.
How do we keep the fire? Don't let the fire burn out. Pass out tracts constantly. We're coming up. We've got a plan coming soon about having some prepackaged tracts for our church on a weekly basis. Take them with you. Pass them out every single day. We'll spend all we got to spend. We'll spend all we got to spend if we got to print more. All we got to do, pass them out constantly. We got to start getting the habit of saying, boy, if a day goes by and I get a chance to pass out a track, I'm struggling. It's not hard. You know what the hard thing is? Mentally getting yourself prepared to do it. Hey, did you get one of these? I know, it's brutal, right? Did you get one of these? Babe, I'm going to tell him the crazy story. Pastor Ray, my first pastor, the guy is a soul-winning machine. I have never in my entire life, Brother Rick, he is Carl Hatch. I'm telling you, he is that way. He's not as mean as Carl Hatch is, but he is that driven. He is, in modern society, some of you know him and know who he is known as the soul-winning pastor in our generation now. I mean, he is after it all the time. He is soul win. When I was there, he would soul win between 15 and 20 hours a week. He's like, I'm not sitting in my office. I got to go out. And we'd go out with him. One time, we had some tracks and we had some flyers for a big day going on. And man, it was stinking hot outside. It was hot. We always have these big days, like worse weather. So hot. Guys, you thirsty? I'm thirsty. I need something refreshing. So we went to Jamba Juice. It's just Jamba Juice, like Smoothie King. Some of you have been other places besides here. You know what Jamba Juice is. It's like Smoothie King. All right? So we went there to Jamba Juice, and we went inside and got something to drink, whatever. And we came out, and he had all these tracks with him. It's a big day. He just started standing outside the Jamba Juice, and he went like, he just held them up. As people walked by, he's Jamba? Jamba, 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 Jamba. People just took it. They thought it was a cool. Some people read it. Okay, what's this? You know, and some people legitimately took it. Oh, okay. There's a Carnival Sunday going on. You know, Jamba, Jamba. That's my pastor speaking in tongues out there in front of the Jamba Juice. Jamba, Jamba, Jamba. It was just so outlandish. People didn't know, what are you going to do? Well, okay. Right. You're just going to take, someone sticks something out at you, it's a piece of paper. You're curious enough to at least, well, what is this?
Right.
It's just not hard. The battle is in the mind.
Amen. You got
The battle is in the mind. Go often, pass out tracts constantly, witness often. When you get the opportunity, get into the gospel. Number five, share your testimony.
Amen.
Amen.
Tell them about what Jesus did for you.
Amen.
Share your testimony. Number six, listen to soul-winning messages and read books on soul-winning. And I can give you some wonderful sources for that if you'd like. Listen to soul-winning messages and read books on it. Keep the fire burning.
Amen.
Number seven, and this sounds a little pragmatic, but it works. Go to the poor. Find yourself a down and out place and go tell them about Jesus. You'll find they'll be pretty responsive. Brother Rick, nothing like a good trailer court or set of rundown apartments to get the soul winning juices flowing. They love it, man. When it's on Saturday, they say, okay, we're going to some apartments. We're going to some trailer. I watched some of you predators out there. You're like, yes, here we go. Finally, no more $500,000 homes. If you're struggling, you know, go find. Even Jesus knew that it was harder for the rich man to get saved, for the camel to pass through the eye of a needle. It's hard. Look, I'm not saying we ought not to tell that, and we will continue to tell the rich too. But, man, if you're struggling, you need to pick me up, go to the poor. Go find some down-and-out people and tell them about the Savior. Number eight, and I hope this will be a reality for us, at least in the coming years, go to the mission field. You want to get on fire about soul winning, about the gospel. The hardest thing about going on a missions trip, can I tell you what it is? Coming back. Because you go to a place where everyone wants to listen.
Amen.
Where people will walk miles and miles and hours and hours and hours to go hear what this one random person they've never met has to say. You want to get on fire and see what the gospel can do in someone's life, go tell somebody who's never even heard the name of Jesus and watch them go, there's a God who died for me? How do we keep the fire going? Starts right here. And then it works into here. And then it has no choice but to come out here. Let's work on developing a soul winner's heart, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time together tonight. I pray that the message was helpful to our people. God, that you would do a work in our hearts, please. God, in my calloused heart, and maybe others like it here in this room, that we develop a fire for the souls that are all around us. God, help us not to push the responsibility off onto any other person, but help us to say, here, my Lord, send me. That we would take responsibility. And Lord, that we develop a heart and a burden. And we let the love that you have for them drive our love for them as well. With every head bowed, every eye closed. Pastor, God spoke to my heart about something today in the messages. He spoke to my heart. Would you just slip up your hand? No one's looking around. Amen. God spoke to my heart about something. Okay. Would you please respond back to the Lord? You can put your hands down. Would you respond back? If he spoke to you, have a conversation with him. God, I appreciate it. Thank you for loving me so much to want to convict me, to want to speak to me. You know, God would speak to you about these things because he thinks your life could be used in a great way. Why would God convict you in this area if he doesn't think that he could use you? Why would he make you feel bad about something if nothing is going to happen if you go? He wants to use your life. There's someone out there you can reach. You can reach. God spoke to your heart. Would you please do business with him tonight? Would you stand together with me? The piano is playing. The invitation is open to you. God, help me to have a soul winner's heart this week. Let's start now. No need to wait. Death is inevitable for every single person. Let's have a soul winner's heart. My offertory said tonight, the whole world was lost in the darkness of sin, but the light of the world is Jesus. Let's give them that light this week, please, would you? Amen. Thank you for being so responsive tonight. Just listen to the Lord. Dear Lord, thank you so much for speaking to us in such a plain way, both this morning and this evening, and helping, Lord, me as I speak to our people. God, I felt very strongly your Holy Spirit guiding what I was to say, and I appreciate so much your help in that way. And God, I pray that these words would ring true in all of our hearts. God, help us to be on fire with a passion and, Lord, a desire to reach the lost. We would not run away from that command. We would not excuse it away, think that we're the exception. God, I pray that we would have the love that you have for these people in our own heart. We would not be distracted from the reality that eternity is coming. We have a short time. Thank you for the message, Lord. I pray it help our church. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for listening so well both this morning and this evening. My goal, my desire by the end of this series, not only is that our heart is in the right place and we're equipped with the right tools, but we'll have some additional plans and some things in place, I think, to give us not only more flexibility, but more opportunities to be able to be an effective witness this coming year for our church. I want to build our church. I want to see us grow. I want to see more people here. That's not a bad desire at all. But I believe that we've got to look beyond just getting people to our church, and we have to have a heart for their soul. Yes. I believe God will bless our church in a greater way if we're more consumed with their soul than just their body sitting in our rows.
Amen.
If we have a passion for soul winning and to win them to Christ, I believe we'll see a good side effect. Because, look, you want to get somebody to church, introduce them to the Savior.
Amen.
Become their spiritual parent and watch them follow you. They were not with us today, and I can't take all the credit for this, but, Brother Gary brought Kevin. I'm sorry, they invited him and brought him to church.
Amen.
And I had the privilege to help lead him to the Lord. And now he's here, not just because he wants to be in our church, but he knows this is where he found the Savior. He's going to learn more about the Savior here.
Amen.
The Woodlands, they were gone. They were out of town today. But they've been in our church because someone invited them. And they sat in my office individually, one and then the other. And I got to lead them to the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
We've got to reach their soul. Well, how are they going to stick in our church? Well, where are they going to develop a spiritual appetite if they don't get saved? Do we expect them to sit here and want to come to church in the flesh? We've got to win them to the Lord and get them on that path to spiritual growth. So let's not be selfish in the sense of, well, we just need to get people here. Well, there might be a simpler solution to that problem. They might be more willing to come here if this is the place that sent them the truth, the gospel.
Amen.
So just something to think about tonight. Thank you for being here. I hope we can see you again on Wednesday night for our Bible study and prayer time. Let's not forget to register for some of these events that are coming up very, very soon. And I hope those will be a blessing to you as well. And I think that's about it. Brother Tennant, is there anything I'm missing for tonight? You didn't go buy any ice cream or anything for us? Well, boy, it was a good night for some ice cream, wasn't it? Tacos and ice cream. I apologize for helping you ruin your diet tonight. But I love you very much. I hope that God will speak to your heart this week. Let's listen for his voice and say yes, shall we?
Amen.
Let's listen for his voice and say yes. Have a great evening. Stick around for a while. But I hope to see you on Wednesday night.